Welcome to Why Is This Happening to Me Again? I'm assuming since you're here that you've asked yourself that question before and wondered what you can do about it. Well, today Michael's going to present a tool of what you can do. But how many of you have a toolbox at home? Even if it's a can with a screwdriver, okay. If you never use a tool out of the toolbox, you might as well not have it. It's the same thing with the tool that Michael's going to present today. It's one thing to leave here today and say, oh, I understand it, I've got it. But if you never put it to work, if you never use the tool, you're not going to see any difference. So I hope that you'll take it out of your toolbox and use it. So I'm going to ask you two questions to start with. How many of you have ever held a newborn baby? Awesome. Go back to holding that newborn and tap into its essence. Not that it was crying because of the way it was jerked into the world, but the essence of the newborn. And put a word to it to describe it. Give me your list slow enough that I can keep up with you and put it on the board. And describe that newborn. Innocent. And I'm going to write that as inner sense. Okay? My word is awesome. Purity. Open. How about miracle? Okay. Vulnerable. Now, vulnerable is its state, but what about its essence? Love. Trusting. About sweet. Infinite potential. Okay, hold on. Joy, gift, and oneness. Okay, I'm at the bottom of the board. That's a good list. Notice that all of these are some variation on the theme of love. I offer that this is your being. You just described who is in the room today. So I have a second question. How many have ever done something that now you regret that you did it? It's okay to answer that. I'm not going to ask for a confession. All right. Go back to one time when you did something that now you regret that you did it, and think of what you were feeling at the time that motivated you to do whatever it was you did, and give me that list. Rage, fear, desperation, desperate, anger, shame, frustration. Resentful and hurt. Confused. How about hopeless? Okay. Notice that this list is some variation of either hostility or fear. Oops. And I offer that this is non-being. So what has to happen? You know, we come in the world as this inner sense, awesome, purity, open, miracle, love, trusting, sweet, infinite potential, joy, gift, and oneness. And then all of a sudden we experience this list. You know, we come in and this is who we are. And then because of our environment, experiences, the people who raise us, and they don't know any better either. But somewhere along the way, usually around the age of 3, we start thinking that we are not enough and we have to do something else or be something else. And we layer ourselves with this. It reminds me of several years ago, Michael and I did Thanksgiving dinner at our local Salvation Army in Tennessee. And most of the people there were our street people. And this one lady in particular, she had on everything that she owned. She had on, you know, shirts and jackets and scarves and hats and pants and shorts and skirts. And she looked like the Michelin man. She had so many clothes on. And it was hot and she was sweating. And it was like, you know, take off some of your layers and be comfortable. And there was no way. I mean, that's all she had. And she thought she had to hang on to it. It was her protection. And that's what we do. We come in as this. We layer ourselves with this. And we think we have to keep it. Well, the tool that Michael's going to present is how we can peel that back off and get back to being who we're designed to be. So at this time, I will turn it over to my wonderful husband and teacher, Michael.
Thank you, dear heart. Awesome. Welcome to Why Is This Happening to Me Again? And what you can do about it. The workshop that we're about to do was originally designed to be a two-week workshop. And it was difficult to get people to sit still for 2 weeks, so what I've done is cut it down to about 4 hours. I'm going to ask you to listen fast, because I'm going to cover a lot of territory. Jeannie opened a space with two options for living. Really, only two possibilities. You live from the left side of the board, you live from the right side of the board. I guess a third possibility is some combination of the two. But obviously, most people would prefer to stay over on the left, and what we're going to offer to you is the how-to embody living from the left side of the board. And because our minds are filled with so much data, there's so many issues to be addressed that if I presented the tool that we're going to ultimately unfold today, now, you'd probably say, Rice, you're crazy, I'm out of here. If I do my job properly in the next couple of hours, when we present the how-to of first century Aramaic forgiveness, you're gonna go, oh, I see why and how that will work, and I'm inspired to use it, because maybe I spend too much time over here. And one of the things you'll notice, if you spend a lot of time over here, your mind is going to have a million excuses for why you shouldn't be living over here, why you don't deserve to live over here, and why you aren't going to do what it takes to make that movement. Hopefully, we can inspire you to do that with seeing the possibility that it can be done. If you go back into the ancient teachings, you hear the man named Yeshua saying that you have to have the eyes to see and the ears to hear in order to comprehend what he's talking about. We're going to spend the next 3 hours or so building the eyes to see and the ears to hear. I think we can fairly safely assume that most everybody in his audience had what we call physical eyes and ears. So he obviously wasn't talking about that. He was talking about those who have the brain cells, that is, the content in their mind to comprehend truly what is happening in their lives, in their minds, in their bodies, and in the world. So we're going to spend some time building brain cells. And I want you to know up front that my purpose is building brain cells, not necessarily to teach you the material. We'd have to spend a whole lot more time together. I promise you, if this is the first time you've heard this workshop, then the second time you'll go, wow, was I ever at that workshop before? And the 20th time you'll go, did I sit in that workshop once before? The 50th time you'll say, have I ever heard this material before? And each time what happens is you'll build new brain cells, and the next time there'll be another level of comprehension, another level of understanding. So my purpose in this initial part of the workshop is to support you in building brain cells. I'm going to cover a lot of territory very quickly. I don't know. I may never get to see you again. This may be the only exposure you're going to get. And so I'm going to cover as much material as I can. You don't need to keep up with it. You don't need to write it all down. You don't need to comprehend it all. It's about building brain cells. And then, if I do my job properly, when we get to the tool, you'll understand why and how it works. Most people in our culture live in a specific state. In fact, I've actually considered petitioning the government to create a 51st and 52nd state because most people live there. You know, probably the greatest atrocity done to us as human beings down through the ages and that we've bought into is that we've had hidden from us the fact that we are by nature creators. We are creative beings. You and I create the results in our lives, and most everybody loves the idea of being a creator. When the creation's going well, when it's not going so well, virtually everybody knows who the problem is. And their name is always them. If only they do it differently, my life would be okay. How many here, you've got somebody in your life, if they change, your life would get better? Okay? Liar, liar, pants on fire. Okay? You're not telling yourself the truth. If only you change the content of your mind, your life would get better. What's the 51st state? It's a state virtually everybody lives in. It's called denial. When I think or speak a thought that somebody else has to change for my life to improve, I hide from myself the part of my mind that I need to change for my life to improve. You'll notice if you've been through a particular painful reality 87 different times with 42 different people, you're the only one that was there every time. It's about you, it's not about them. And so when we enter into this state of denial, and again, very important definition, when I think or speak a thought that somebody else is the cause of what I'm feeling, of what I'm experiencing, of what I don't like in my life, I have to hide the part of me with which I create that result over and over and over again. And if you're really honest with yourself, you'll notice you've been through the result you don't like 87 different times with 42 different people. And you're the only one that was there every time. It's about you. It's not about them. As long, however, as you keep pretending that it's somebody else that needs to change for the content of your mind to change, you will not be able to access the part of your mind that you need to change. And so when you live in denial, that 51st state, it leads to the 52nd state. And the 52nd state is confusion, where the rest of the population lives. Always wondering why somebody else is doing it to them and never even having a clue that they're doing it to themselves over and over and over again. So the reason why it keeps happening again is because the part of you with which you create the feelings and you create the result you're experiencing, when you enter into denial, you dissociate from that part. And to dissociate means now the part of you that carries your pain, the part of you that needs to change for you to be free of pain, whatever anybody else is doing, is now hidden from you. It's removed from your awareness by your denial. You know, there's some interesting Harvard research that says that in a time frame where 10,000 brain cells fire, the maximum amount of data that goes into conscious awareness, into your perception, is 9 bits of data. And this device called your mind, when you start realizing you're looking at 9 bits of data out of 10,000 brain cells firing, what you're looking at with this 9 bits of data is evidence. Selected information goes into building your perception, and that's all you get to see. When you live in denial, you're saying to your mind, don't show me the part of me that causes this pain. Show me that it's all somebody else's fault. You see, the truth is we live in a world of make-believe. First we make it up, and then we believe it, and then we go out and we produce evidence to prove that it's true. And all of the evidence that shows up in your mind is evidence of your own BS. Somebody's laughing. Is it? That's belief system. Does somebody have a different reality for those initials? If the output of your mind outputs something different than belief system for those initials, I'm going to invite you to notice that's your reality. Now, I have people who've actually gotten offended when I put those initials on the board. Why would anybody get offended about belief system? Because the reality in their mind is something different. And they live in denial all their lives. And living in denial all their lives, everything else is the cause of their pain. Why would you write those terrible initials BS on the board? Notice the upset. If you could imagine yourself being upset about those initials, would come from the content of your mind and the reality in your mind about those initials. It wouldn't come from my mind or what they mean written on the board. Belief system. Yet, most people never comprehend that everything that is traumatic to them, everything that is painful, everything that creates emotional turmoil is an inside job. Why don't they realize that? It seems so obvious once you have the brain cells to see it. Well, it is obvious unless you live in denial. Because when you live in denial, you in essence say to your mind, when you say, anybody ever said this to somebody? You made me really mad. You hurt me. You really upset me. That situation really disturbed me. Now, each of those phrases is called denial. And what I'm saying to my evidential mind is, mind, show me a reality that somebody else is the cause of what's going on inside of me. My mind can only build an hallucination now out of the brain cells that I hold about you. And my mind will show me that you're the problem in my life. And what really is the problem and what really causes me to feel and builds my pain, I am in denial of. And when I dissociate from something, that which I dissociate from, I wear right here on my sleeve. Everybody in Dodge knows about it except me, because I've hidden it from myself. And so people come along, they read the instructions, they follow the instructions, and they do it to me again. And again, and again. And I keep saying, why are all people like that? Why are they doing this to me again? And I don't know that I'm the one who's giving the instruction set. I'm wearing it right there where everybody in town can read it. And once I put it out there, guess who's coming to dinner? It's going to be somebody who knows exactly how to read those instructions and exactly how to play off of it with me. Until I learn to undo my denial and access the part of my mind with which I ask for these things. I used to speak every year, keynote at a conference called Global Sciences out in Colorado. And back about probably 34, 35 years ago, there was a 23-year senior scientist from IBM, a fellow named Marcel Vogel, who presented at the conference a couple of years, the same years as I did. And Marcel brought a camera with him. And his camera was a camera that took a picture of the high energy waves that leave the mind when we think a thought. Literally, once you plant an energy within your structure, that energy, by definition, is motion. Anything that creates motion sets up an energy wave. And every energy wave calls toward itself that which matches it. And so let's say if I hold a belief in my belief system that people always hurt me in relationships. What do you suppose this high energy wave is continuously communicating to the world? What it communicates is, hey world, I'm supposed to be hurt in relationship. Is there anybody that knows exactly how to hurt me the way I'm supposed to be? And through resonance, through the energetic dynamics of how the world is set up, that person is going to move toward me. Resonance is the law of energy systems. Simply stated, it says this: whenever two energy systems are in tune or in harmony with each other, there's an exchange of information between them. You probably remember back in high school physics class, you took a middle C tuning fork, you hit it on a desk, and the second tuning fork, when you put a second middle C in front of it, started to vibrate. Without being touched, that second tuning fork starts to move. How did that happen? Well, literally, because the atomic magnetic structure of the two was the same, there was an exchange of energy between them, and the secondary took on some of the energy of the primary and started to vibrate in response. That's called resonance. If I had two pianos sitting here on the floor, and I went over and I hit the middle C keys on one of the pianos, I could go over and open up the second piano, and there are hundreds of strings in there. Do you know what keys are going to be vibrating in that piano? Only middle C. By me hitting and setting up a frequency with this piano, the second piano takes on the energy in the strings that match, and those strings start to move. It's called the law of resonance. So resonance causes motion. Now, in the world of pianos, because they're inanimate objects, there's just motion. But in the human world, where we are animate, there's not only motion, but there is motion toward. When I set up a frequency, I will resonate, attract, or draw somebody to me to play that out with me. Many people are talking about the law of attraction, and they're looking for it to get stuff. Well, if you're doing that with the law of attraction, then the law of attraction is your distraction. Because when you start using it to get your stuff, rather than start using it to recognize what you're drawing to you and what is in you that needs to be removed, so that you don't draw that anymore, you'll keep wondering why this is happening to me again. The person who focuses on money attracts money, and if they let their focus go for a moment, and what underlies their belief system is, I'm supposed to be broke, guess what? Somebody's gonna show up that's gonna take the money. Forgiveness from the first century Aramaic language was the tool for how to access the hidden parts of the mind and clean out what never belonged. When you access and remove those parts of your mind that you've dissociated from, what happens is you erase this high energy wave by removing that which set up the wave in the first place. Start thinking of forgiveness as removal, rather than forgiveness as, this is moving in me again, it's all your fault, but I'll let you off the hook, I'll forgive you. Never forgive anybody ever again for anything, because forgiveness isn't about letting other people off the hook because something is moving in you. Forgiveness is about going inside of you and removing what never belonged there. But you can't remove what you've dissociated from, because you've dissociated from it. And now it's hidden from you. You don't know it's there anymore. That's what's called an unconscious mind, an artificially created state in the human organism that is created through denial. And so what we don't know is there keeps producing results until we are able to access it and remove it, called forgiveness. And so as opposed to letting other people off the hook because something is moving in you or something is moving between you and someone else, instead, stop your denial, Go inside, find a part of your mind that set you up for that and remove it. Do you really want your life to change? Then all you have to do is face every bit of energy in you that's based in hostility or fear and remove it. It's no small task. It's a significant amount of work. Otherwise, here's what happens. Once again, you put an energy in you, rage, guilt, grief, whatever it is. It's a frequency in motion. It sets up an energy wave. Somebody in resonance with that wave, because they are a live system as you are, moves toward you and does the behavior that's triggered by this high energy wave in you. And what happens is you file away that information you don't want to deal with deep in the hidden recesses of your mind, dissociated from it, and the very content that causes your pain, which is inside of you, is now inaccessible to you. And this person is going to do the behavior that will resonate those brain cells. Let's see if that's true. How many here have ever gone into somebody's space, totally committed to being loving, nurturing, and caring, and all of a sudden found yourself functioning like a mad banshee? Anybody ever done that one? What happened? I don't even think like that. I don't talk like that. I don't do those things. What happened? Here's what happened. The law of resonance took over. You have a matching bag of garbage that matches the file that they have. And that resonant energy wave sets in motion your mad banshee. And your mad banshee, resonated or activated, starts to move in you, takes over your behavior, and has you doing whatever it is that you said you never wanted to do again. You know, many people who hear that explanation go, oh, good, Michael, thank you for verifying that it's their fault that it's happening. You'll notice that's not what I said. What I said is, you have a mad banshee. And when you meet somebody who has a matching bag of garbage, guess what? Two people have the opportunity to heal. The person who attracted the mad banshee and the person who has the mad banshee. If each of those stops their denial and dissociation, then they will apply the tool of forgiveness, access what is painful in them, and remove it. But what the average person does is this. They draw somebody in again. The person does the behavior that rattles these brain cells. When these brain cells fire, they use the data in them that is rattled to produce their brain's image of the person in front of them. They produce a picture. And the picture's made of what's firing in them. When you make pictures out of the content of your brain cell structure, that's called projection. So the natural end cycle of denial and dissociation is projection. That is, I'll take the brain cells that the person with the mad banshee resonates in me, I'll make a picture, and I swear that picture's actually them, but I've really projected the content of my brain cell structure into my brain's image of them, and because it comes from my brain cell structure, they show up in my mind with my problem attached, and I swear it must be their problem. But you'll notice you're the one that's feeling it. Now, we've developed a test in this work for determining whether or not something you're feeling is yours or not. It's a very complex test. It's a very difficult test to understand and to apply. But with a little bit of practice, you can do it. How do I tell if something I'm feeling is mine or not? Am I feeling it? That's all I need to know. Once I realize I'm feeling it, I realize that I can only feel the content of my own mind and that this is about me and it's mine. And I'm the one who's going to have to change the root of my feelings and the creative wave that goes out that brings somebody in to do it to me again and again and again. Now, this dissociated mind only opens one way. In first century Aramaic forgiveness, they knew exactly how to open that mind. And what has to happen is the projection has to collapse. If whatever you're doing isn't collapsing the projection in your mind, you're not going to forgive. When the projection collapses, a pathway into the hidden part of the mind has to open. When the pathway into the hidden part of the mind has to open, the material that is dissociated from is able to come forward directly, and if a secondary condition is met, that is, there is the active presence of love in this mind, there is a human life existing here, then what happens when this dissociated content comes forward in the presence of love, it automatically and spontaneously begins to dissolve. And that's precisely what forgiveness does. Now, you might remember the song title back a few decades ago now, Wishing and Hoping and Praying and Playing. How many remember that song? I'll tell you what. You can do all the wishing, hoping, praying, and planning you want. Your dissociated mind isn't going to open. Once you enter into denial and say to your mind, mind, you are not allowed to show me that this is my information and that I'm doing this to myself, then until you find the right technology, and it is a powerful technology, until you find the technology with which to collapse the projection, open the pathway to the dissociated part of the mind, bring that material directly forward to awareness in the presence of love, that stuff's not going to dissolve. And you're going to be saying to yourself, 2 years, 10 years, 50 years, 500 years from now, 5,000 years from now, why is this happening to me again? Or you can tell a lot about what's going on in people's lives. We'll get a phone call at our center, and people are looking for the book, Why Is This Happening to Me Again? I understand you have this book titled, Why Are They Doing This to Me Again? Or Why Am I Doing This to Myself Again? Okay? You're a creator. If you can't take responsibility for your creations, then you can't access and change the part of your mind that's in need of healing. You know, in the time frame where 9 bits of data show up, 10,000 brain cells fire, it's been estimated that there are approximately 20 trillion bits of data potentially available from the actual world. So here we are, living in a 20 trillion bit world with 10,000 brain cells firing, looking at 9 bits of data and thinking we know what's going on out there. When the truth is, whatever shows up in our minds always tells us more about the content of our minds than the world we think we're looking at. Let's see if that one's true. Has anybody here ever been accused of saying something you absolutely never said, of doing something you absolutely never did? Anybody been accused? Oh, hey, good. Everybody, awesome, all right. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. When the person who accused you, which side of the board were they on? The left side or the right side? Were they in this inner sense, awesome, purity, open, miraculous, loving, trusting space? Or were they in some form of rage, fear, desperation, anger, shame, frustration, resentment, hurt, confusion, or hopelessness? Which side of the board were they on? Notice, 100% of the time, they were on the right side of the board. How do I know that? Because the only way one can make a mistake of projecting what's inside of them on someone else is that their minds are using corrupt data. And hostility and fear is an infallible signal that your mind is using corrupt data. You need know nothing else about a circumstance or a situation except that hostility or fear accompanies the output of the mind to know that this person is living in corrupt data and needs help, needs support. And the support that's needed is the dissolution of the hostility and fear-based data, the healing of the mind. If you don't ever get to the point where you begin to remove literally your very capacity for hostility or fear from your mind, then sooner or later, people are going to trip over your painful realities. And when they trip over those and activate your hostility or fear, you're going to create a projection that it's all their fault. And you will swear that they're the problem in your life. Because your mind is showing you an hallucination, a picture based in corrupt data. Don't need to know anything else. Is there hostility or fear involved in what I'm seeing? Then my mind is using corrupt data. Now, it was obvious for you to see that when they accused you of doing what you didn't do, saying what you didn't say, it was obvious they were in an hallucination, right? But it's tricky when it's your hallucination because you believe the root of your hallucinations. You really believe they did do what it is you're accusing them of. Every time your mind builds a reality based in hostility or fear, you're living in an hallucination. Most people love their hallucinations. Most people love their hallucinations far more than they have any interest whatsoever in truth. So most people live in blockage of truth. What does that mean? Well, if you fill your nine slots, your nine-bit mind, with data based in hostility or fear, and you call your corrupt data and its reality truth, then there is no room for truth to get into awareness. And by holding a lie and calling it truth, you are now living in blockage of truth. How many people on the planet are living in blockage of truth virtually consistently? Anybody whose continuous perception is based in hostility or fear. They love their lies more than they love the truth. The antidote for blockage of truth is love of truth. You got to move in the direction of love of truth. I've been through this painful reality 87 different times with 42 different people. Every time it comes up, I talk about my spouse. Maybe talking about my spouse and blaming them for the fact that I feel something that I knew how to feel before I ever met them. In fact, I knew how to feel that decades before I met them. Maybe I'm lying to myself when I say it's my spouse. Maybe I'm in blockage of truth. Maybe I need to unblock my mind and start to love truth enough to start to unload my hostility, fear, and blame game that it's all about everybody else. Maybe I need to come out of my denial. You know, you can go all the way back. The Aramaic language, you know, is the root of this work. And the Aramaic language, interestingly enough, is the root language of at least six of the world's major religions. And it's not a religious language. The Aramaic is a physics language. It's a physiological language. It's a genetic language. It's an energy system language. It's a psychological language. It describes exactly how this energy system works. That's why so many religions have come out of it, because there was truth there. And men, in their hostility and fear-based minds, not understanding truth, made up stories based in hostility and fear. And when they made up stories based in hostility or fear, they said, hey, this sounds like a pretty good religion, let's go for it. And then anybody who didn't believe them, they'd go out and kill, but they'd kill them, you know, to send them to heaven, to take care of their souls. You know, I mean, the craziness that's gone on in the name of religion down through the ages is absolutely amazing. But when you go back to the Aramaic, you find a description of exactly how the world works. And if you don't love truth enough to let truth in, to stop your lies, then you can't live in the actual world. You will always live in the realities between your ears. And your realities that happen between your ears are always pictures from brain cells firing. Let's use an example. Let's imagine that we have a young man, and, you know, he's born in a small town, one-room school, kindergarten to grade 12, mom is his teacher. And mom is an artist, wonderful woman. And she uses markers to do her art. How many here see a marker in my hand? Give a show of hands. Okay, everybody in the room says they see a marker. I'm going to challenge you. I don't think you see the marker in my hand. If you could see the marker in my hand, we could cover the windows, turn out the lights, make this room totally dark, and you'd still see the marker. But if we extract the light energy from this room, notice you don't see any vestige of a marker. Why? Because you're not seeing the marker in my hand now. What's happening is information carried on frequencies of light enter your eye. I promise you, nobody jammed a marker in your eye so you could see it in your brain. I promise you, no marker went in your eye. All that went into your eye was information that bounced off of the marker. So here we have the marker. We have light energy. It bounces off of the marker, hits your eye, and that light energy causes brain cells to fire. And your brain produces a picture that you call the marker in my hand. And the picture is a picture that is output from the content of your brain cell structure. So let's imagine our young man, kindergarten to grade 12, mom's the teacher, awesome woman, fun, wonderful woman. They have a wonderful relationship. You know, every day at school, he stays after school while she takes care of the other kids and does things, and he's markering away, and his mom's showing him how to do art. In fact, now, 30 years later, he's a world-famous marker artist. So he has a lot of brain cells, a lot of content for markers. They're wonderful, they're fun, they're enlivening. It's how I do my livelihood. It's just, you know, great. And so when I present the marker, his brain, out of the brain cells that fire, this light energy goes in the eye, resonates this content, and this content causes him to feel and see something. And he sees a marker in his mind. That marker is unique and individual to him. The marker in my hand is actuality. The marker in his mind is his reality. Right now, if we've got 50 people in the room, there are 51 markers. There's one in my hand, and there's one in each of our brains. And the one in my hand can never be the one in your brain, and the one in your brain can never be the one in my hand. Unique individual output gives each of us a picture of everything we see. The pictures always tell us more about the content that they come from than the world of actuality. Let's imagine we've got a second young man who was brought up in a similar circumstance to the first. Kindergarten to grade 12, same teacher, it's mom. But mom isn't very kind. In fact, mom's kind of vicious. She uses markers, and she likes everybody to know what a screw-up her son is, and how bad he is. And every time he makes a mistake, she centers him out and drives him down into the dirt. And the way she uses markers is she's a pretty good shot, and every time he steps on a line, she fires one at his head. And on at least two occasions, he turned his head the wrong way and got a marker in the eye and ended up in the hospital. Now, this young man also has a file on markers. When I present this marker and light energy bounces off of it and hits his eye, he gets a picture in his mind. It is a picture in his mind of the same marker that the other young man is looking at? Absolutely not. Does the marker produce the fear, the hostility in this young man, or the love and the yearning to do art in this young man? No, it's the content of their minds that do that. Now, is there any particular category or group of people or situation that would take the place of the marker? Maybe somebody in your life or some particular category of people in your life, and you say, they make me mad. They hurt me. They really have a problem. You ever say that to somebody? You really have a problem. I have a question for you. If they're the one with the problem, why are you the one with the pain? Something about that doesn't make sense. If they're the one with the problem, they'd be the one with the pain. If you're the one with the pain, maybe you have a problem and you don't know it. Maybe you live so steeped and so deep in denial, you don't have a clue what you're doing to yourself. And guess what? If your mind produces realities about hostility and fear and you're talking about someone else, you don't have a clue what's going on in your world. And you're in trouble, deep trouble. The solution is to begin to understand how your own perceptual system works, and that if your body-mind unit is feeling some sort of pain, then it's time for you to take charge of that pain and to change it. Pain results when we put a frequency into this system that doesn't belong in this system. If we listen to Einstein, Einstein says this, and this is one of the foundations of this work. He says, on such things as matter, we have been all wrong. What we have heretofore called matter is energy, energy whose vibrations have been so lowered as to be perceptible to the senses. There is no matter. Einstein says, matter doesn't exist. You don't have a body. You don't live in a world of bodies. You live in a world of energy. Now, maybe you know better than Einstein. Most of science still hasn't caught up with him. Most of so-called scientists still don't have a clue what he was talking about. They're still living with the material gods in the material world, and they believe in stuff and things and real physical things and real physical causes. So they're struggling to try to fix real physical causes when there's no physical. Doesn't exist. You have, instead of a body, an energy system. Remember I said I want brain cells firing for you? I just want to build some brain cells. You have an energy system. Relative to your energy system, there are two qualities of energy. There's that which builds the system up. It's called integrative energy. There's that which tears the system down. It is called disintegrative energy. Interestingly enough, in the ancient Aramaic language, the word that was used to describe disintegrative energy is the word sin. And sin is an archery term. When you fired at the bullseye and you missed the target, the scorekeeper will yell, sin. You're off the mark. That's all it means. Maybe that's some new brain cells for you. Maybe somebody's taught you something different. Maybe somebody's even taught you to have an identity based on that word. And it's all a lie. Your identity will always be true and will always be the same. You are the experience of love. You are made of the stuff called love. If you bought into something else, you bought into the biggest lie on the planet. You are not made of this stuff. This is no inherent part of you, though you may have gone there and spent time there, and it's time to stop and start to dump all of the energies that don't belong in your system. You know, when they said the wages of sin is death, it wasn't some kind of theological threat, God's going to get you for your sins. They were just saying that when you put an energy into the structure that doesn't belong in the structure, wherever you put it, the tissue starts to fall apart. You get enough tissue falling apart and you die. And when the tissue starts to fall apart, it says, ouch, it hurts. The only cause of pain is putting a frequency into your structure that doesn't belong. But you keep saying they hurt you. Liar, liar, pants on fire. Nobody can hurt you. But if you're sending out a signal of how to be hurt, hey, there'll be a whole procession of people that will come and know exactly how to fire those brain cells. And you will say they hurt you if you don't know any better. But the truth is, when they came to show you your hurt, they were giving you a gift. And the gift was, what I've dissociated from, instead of projecting it into my brain's image of them, I can now realize that this is mine, and I can begin to engage in the forgiveness process and erase those things. How deep, ultimately, does the erasure need to go? Well, if you go back to the ancient Aramaic genetic language, they said this: the sins of the fathers will be passed, yea, unto 3 and 4 generations. That means you have in your memory bank every frequency taken in by the last 30 lives plus your own, 31 lives. That's what's in your structure. If you didn't know that, then you didn't know what the root of your pain was, and you really believed it when the world taught you it was everybody else's fault. But it's not everybody else's fault. This is a no-fault system. When you realize it's yours, you've got the opportunity to appreciate changing your mind. Let's take a short intermission.